start? Okay. Hello, am I audible? Okay, excellent. Hello everyone and welcome. Aap sabhi ko Ganatantra Divas Mubarak ho. Unpacking the legacy of any historical icon is a tricky thing to do, but when it comes to debating Ambedkar's legacy, it's a particularly tough ask. And I say this because at this point in time, there will be any number of groups, any number of political parties from very different sides of the ideological spectrum who claim him to be their own leader. And in order to be able to analyze the merits of those claims, you first have to answer the question, who was the real Babasaheb Bhimrao Ambedkar? And the problem with that is that the more you read of him and about him, the less you tend to know clearly. Writer and scholar Anand Telatumbre has summed this conundrum up, and if you bear with me, I'd like to quote from his essay. The evolution of Ambedkar, the pragmatic sans any ideological fixation all through his life, makes him intrinsically difficult to understand. A young Ambedkar who theorized castes as the enclosed classes, the enclosure being provided by the system of endogamy and exogamy, expecting the larger Hindu society to wake up and undertake social reforms like intermarriage in order to open up castes into classes, is in contrast to the post-Mahar Ambedkar, disillusioned by the rabid reactions from caste Hindus, turning his sights to politics to accomplish his objective. Were his threats of conversion to Islam for a separate political identity for Dalits, or to force caste Hindus to consider social reforms? Then there is the Ambedkar of the 30s, anxious to expand his constituency to the working classes, sans castes, who founded the Independent Labour Party, arguably the first left party in India, and walked with the communists. But at the same time, one who declared his resolve to convert to some other religion to escape caste. What about the Ambedkar of the 40s, who returns to the caste, dissolves the ILP and forms the Scheduled Caste Federation, shuns agitational politics and joins the colonial government as labor minister? Or the one who wrote States and Minorities, propounding state socialism be hard-coded into the proposed Constitution of Free India? Or Ambedkar, the staunchest opponent of the Congress, or the one who cooperated with the Congress in joining the all-party government and accepted its support to get into the Constituent Assembly? Or even the Ambedkar who developed the representation logic culminating in reservations, expecting that a few advanced elements from among Dalits would help the community progress, or the one who publicly lamented that educated Dalits had let him down? Or the Ambedkar, who was the architect of the constitution and advised Dalits to adopt only constitutional methods for a resolution of their problems, or the one who disowned it in the harshest possible terms and spoke of being the first person to burn it down? And finally, the Ambedkar, who kept referring to Marx as a quasi-benchmark to assess his decisions, or the one who embraced Buddhism and created the ultimate bulwark against communism in India, or even the one who would favorably compare Buddha and Marx just a few days before bidding adieu to the world, saying their goal was the same, but they differed in the ways of achieving them, and Buddha's being better than Marx's. These are just a few broad vignettes of him, problematic in typifying him in a simplistic manner. If one goes deeper, one is bound to face far more serious problems. But of course, contradictions are not the only problems here. Ambedkar's legacy is truly so vast as to be practically unfathomable. His most popular representation, of course, is as an icon of Dalit emancipation, but clearly he's much more than that. In this panel, we have about 40, 45 minutes, but we are going to try and touch upon Ambedkar's impact on very different facets of the life of this country and its people. And because it's Republic Day, I'm going to start by talking to Chintan a little bit about his contribution to the Constitution. Chintan, this may, to start off with a very quick question, sure. And it may not be an easy one, so bear with me. If I had to ask you to name in bullet points, yeah, perhaps three significant contributions that Ambedkar made to this country by way of constitutional law and constitution, what comes to mind?
Sure. So that's a very difficult question to start the day.
It is.
Not what I had in mind after having a lovely dosa for breakfast, but coming to think of it, I mean, I've thought of three contributions at different levels of abstraction. One of them is a contribution which can be related to a specific article of the Constitution. The other is seen in the nature of the document itself. And the third is something that you see embedded through the text, but which you can't find in any particular provision. The first contribution I'd identify is Article 32 of the Constitution, which is the right to constitutional remedies. And in the debates, Ambedkar was particularly keen for the right to move the Supreme Court to enforce fundamental rights, to be a fundamental right in and of itself. He was very conscious of bills of rights that are essentially shams. In other words, bills of rights where there's a chasm between theory and practice, and which can't really be enforced in the courts. And therefore, I think his first most significant contribution was his insistence upon ensuring that the right to move the court is itself guaranteed as a fundamental right. The second is his contribution in through the debates, actually, in ensuring that the Constitution is quite a lengthy and detailed document. At the time of its enactment, the Constitution consisted of 395 articles and 8 schedules. Now it's in fact much longer. It's roughly over 450 articles and 12 schedules. Even today, it's amongst the longest constitutions in the world. At many stages of the debate, matters that would have not typically been included in a democratic constitution were decided to be set out and codified in ours. And this happened in two ways. First, either you codify conventions or practices, which are typically just followed as a matter of practice rather than encapsulated in the text. The second is that our constitution includes many, many issues which typically would be left to ordinary legislation. Matters such as the composition of panchayats, the appointment of district judges, these are not really issues that you'd find in modern day constitutions, but which you'd find in ours. And just very briefly, think about the reason for which our constitution is so long in detail. And I think one of the major key reasons for this is that we're inherently skeptical as a society. We're inherently skeptical about the fact that if we don't write things down, then people will assume to the contrary. And so conventions won't actually be followed. The Constitution, therefore, if you look at it today, is a very messy document. You won't exactly call it a beautiful, easy-to-read document. It's not a document that you can read in a matter of 2 minutes sitting in a coffee shop, as you would the American Constitution. But I think the messiness of our Constitution reflects the organized chaos that is our country, that's India. I think the third significant contribution, and you won't really find this written anywhere in the Constitution, is this idea of constitutional morality, which Ambedkar speaks about through the course of the debates. The key principle here is that Ambedkar disavows the very tactics and strategies that were employed during the freedom movement, including satyagraha, including civil disobedience. And his point was that under a democratic constitution, you have to play by the rules, and the manner in which you challenge the administration is through a culture of argument. There's no longer going to be a question of violating the rules, of breaking the law, but you resolve disagreements in a civil way through argument and through debate. And I think that's reflected in several provisions of the Constitution. So that's what I would count as the third very significant contribution of Ambedkar.
I just want to come back to Article 32 that you spoke about. In your book,
yes,
you sort of use data and you use analysis to compare the two models of judicial review.
Yes.
The model in the UK,
yeah,
where courts can make a declaration of incompatibility,
right,
but it's up to the parliament essentially to take that or not.
Yeah.
And in India, which is somewhat like in the US, the,
yeah,
Supreme Court can strike down legislation that it thinks is incompatible with the Constitution. And if I'm not mistaken, Ambedkar called this the soul,
yeah,
of the,
yes,
Constitution.
Yes.
Clearly, it was very important to him. But as we all know, the parliament and state legislatures,
yeah,
can and do very often,
yeah,
find ways around,
yeah,
Supreme Court rulings in this regard.
Yeah.
So why do you think this was as important as it was to Ambedkar?
Right.
Why did he choose this over what was prevalent in the UK, given that we were taking a lot of our cues from the UK at,
sure,
that given point in time? And of course, what is the legacy of how Article 32 has maybe played out in practice.
Sure. At the time that the Constitution was enacted, there were really two viable alternatives available in terms of the model of judicial review. The first was parliamentary supremacy, which was the model that existed in the UK, which meant that Parliament is supreme, and anything that the Queen and Parliament, as they call it in the UK, enacts is law, and cannot as such be challenged or struck down in a court of law. The other alternative was American-style judicial review. Judicial review which enables the courts to review statutes enacted by a democratically elected majority and actually strike them down if they violate fundamental rights. Now, in the debates, there's almost an assumption. It's very interesting that there's almost an assumption that American-style judicial review would be adopted. The members of the Assembly don't discuss this in as much detail as I would have expected. And I think the reason for this is the wider political climate at the time. So where this is an environment, this is a post-war environment, after the world had seen the atrocities of majoritarianism in Nazi Germany. And therefore, the thinking at the time was that the only sensible model of constitutionalism at the time was one which did give courts this backstop, this power to strike down legislation that violated important fundamental rights. And therefore, that's the model of review that was adopted. Now, it's one thing to say that you give the courts the power to strike down legislation. But another important empirical question is, how frequently is that power exercised? Is that power merely on paper, or is it exercised in practice? We don't actually have any detailed statistics of how often Indian courts strike down legislation. All that we know is that in the first 10 years, courts were not loath to do so. So in about a quarter of the cases in which legislation was challenged, about 25 to 30%, the courts struck down some or all of the legislation that was challenged. In some instances, Parliament responded by trying to nullify the decision of the court, but that's still very rare. So typically, the reaction of any Parliament anywhere in the world, really, is to do nothing, either by way of ignorance or because they lack the political will to do so. So the typical reaction of any parliament across the world to a judicial decision striking down a statute is to do nothing at all and to obey the court's decision. Now, what is the legacy of this choice? There's one thing that worries me deeply about the legacy of this choice and this model of judicial review. The court's primary function is one of a counter-majoritarian institution. In many cases, particularly cases involving national security, the court has been reluctant to exercise its power to strike down legislation. Significant legislation on anti-terrorism, such as, I think the best example is what we call TADA, which is the Terrorist and Disruptive Activities Act, which contains provisions that on their face seem to violate fundamental rights, have been upheld by the courts. And so there have been instances in which the court has been reluctant to exercise this power, which meant that fundamental rights were not enforced in the way that they should have been.
I wanted to quickly, and I do want to talk to you a little bit about amending the Constitution and Ambedkar's views on that. I don't know if it's going to be a quick answer, but yeah. I'm keen to bring in the other panelists as well. So maybe you can just briefly talk about it, and then we can come back to it later. And essentially, what I'm really after is that Ambedkar seemed very clear-eyed on the one hand about the dangers to the political democracy that was being created at that point in time, if, in his words, revolutionary methods instead of constitutional methods are adopted by the future generations. And yet somehow, when he's in his final address to the Constituent Assembly, he seems to be emphasizing the fact that this generation has very little right to be making a constitution for the following generations. And he seems to be hailing the fact that the constitution here is not set in stone and it's relatively easier to amend it. I remember, and of course the constitution has been amended thereafter several times, and I remember this political cartoon in, I think, Rajiv Dhawan's book, if I'm not mistaken, where there's a man who goes up to a shopkeeper and asks for a copy of the constitution, and the shopkeeper says, I'm sorry, we don't store periodicals. But jibes aside, I just wanted to ask you if you'd quickly want to talk a little bit about whether the power to amend as it stands, the way Ambedkar envisaged it and post Keshav Nand Bharti, of course, has it stood us in good stead as a country? And I think maybe particularly this question becomes poignant when we're at a crossroad where there seems to be misplaced or otherwise anxiety about the ruling dispensation being keen to change the constitution fairly substantially.
Sure. So there was quite an interesting debate in the Constituent Assembly between Nehru and Ambedkar about what the amendment formula should be. Nehru's view was that the constitution should be quite easy to amend, particularly in the first few years. And in fact, at times he almost, I don't think he quite says it in those many terms, but he almost hints to the fact that this is an interim constitution of sorts, which needs to be changed quite substantially in the first 5 to 10 years. Ambedkar's view was different. His view was that what we are doing now is a legacy that must be kept forever or for a period of time, and therefore the constitution should actually be relatively difficult to amend. So as all good politicians do, they arrived at a compromise solution. And what they said was that the constitution can only be amended, in most instances, there are exceptions, by a two-thirds majority, and on federal issues, by ratification of half of the state legislatures. So this was really a compromise between two camps. Which camp won in practice? Now, if you were to think about this in the early years, Nehru clearly won because the constitution was frequently amended and often in quite radical ways. If you were to look, however, post-1973, post the Supreme Court's famous decision in the Keshavanand Bharti case, the constitution has become harder and harder to amend. And so you might well say that Ambedkar's philosophy on constitutional amendment has become more in vogue over the past few decades. Let's look at how often this constitution has been amended in practice. Now, today marks 68 years since the constitution was enacted. There have been over 100 amendments. So on an average, the constitution is amended more than once a year. It's a misnomer. Lots of people say that the Indian constitution is very frequently amended. It's one of the most widely amended constitutions in the world. That's not quite right. There are many other constitutions that are amended far more frequently, such as the Mexican constitution, which has been amended, I think, over 400 or 500 times. And also, I think that the numbers are somewhat misleading. I think you do need to examine what these amendments do in practice. Some of the amendments are radical. They seek to transform the nature of the constitution. So if you were to look at the 42nd, which was enacted during the emergency, it introduced a wide variety of changes, not least adding the word socialist and secular, adding a section on fundamental duties and so on. There are some amendments to the constitution, the 96th, which changed the word Oriya, O-R-I-A, to Odia with a D. So they really do vary in their significance. So I think the numbers don't quite tell the whole picture.
Very quickly, Professor Thorat, maybe any thoughts on this, and you as well, Chintan, before we move on from the constitution, was Ambedkar in the end overall happy with the constitution that he is said to be the architect of? And I ask this particularly because obviously he makes a very impassioned plea in 1947 for the justiciability of socioeconomic rights, that eventually a lot of the principles in his memorandum end up in the as part of the directive principles of state policy. He seems to be okay with that sort of compromise. He defends the constitution in his last address, but then also 50s, he's believed to have said something of the sort that he would be the first to burn the constitution down because in a temple meant for God, devil now resides. I know that I'm not asking you guys to be therapists, but any quick thoughts on was he overall happy with the constitution towards the end of his life?
No, I think, is it working?
Yes, I can hear you.
I think when we want to study this question, whether you are happy, no, yes.
Oh, is it? Maybe it's just the positioning of the mic.
It's okay?
No. Do you have a hand?
Hello? It's okay. Is it possible? You can listen to me?
Yes.
I think this is a question that one has to answer a lot more carefully. There are views of Dr. Ambedkar about the political economic framework, about constitution itself. And Dr. Ambedkar has not been able to incorporate all those views in the constitution. So one has to draw a distinction what views he hold, and secondly, that he being the chairman of the drafting committee, he has to represent the majority view in the assembly. So at time he took a position, he has to defend the majority position, which was at time against his own view. So I think Ambedkar has to be analyzed, his failure and success, or what he wanted in with this methodology. And my feeling is that he was successful in many, many ways. He brought the issues of equality, non-discrimination at the core of the constitutions. He banned untouchability, he passed Untouchability Offence Act, and that he could not bring this state socialism into the constitution. He wanted political and economic structure both to be the part of the constitutional law, which he could not. And then he pursued the assembly and brought a social economic transformation agenda into directive principle, that the state should keep in mind while framing the policy, whether that policies lead to social or economic transformation. So I think Ambedkar was pragmatic, and he wanted to maximize as much as he could. Imagine a single Ambedkar from his party, even in the second term as a chairman, he was on the Congress ticket. But I think given his political position, he has done wonderfully well. At the same time, he has not been able to put in all that he wanted. His constitution was state and minorities. He wanted state socialism to be a part of the constitution because he thought political democracy will not be successful unless there is an economic democracy at the end, at the base. Poverty lead to violation of rights. And he wanted social democracy. And he repeated it while commenting on the aims and objective of the constitution, Nehru's resolution. He submitted in the state and minority, and a disparate Ambedkar at the end in his last lecture, he warned that if you don't have economic and social democracy, this very structure which have been laboriously built up by the member will be blown away by the people if they continue to suffer. So I think he got quite a lot. He got quite a lot for the Dalit, I think. He got reservation policy, he got legal restriction against untouchability and caste, and he tried to maximize to the extent possible. I think his contribution was phenomenal. Let me take just one word. I think we are focusing too much on constitution. Ambedkar's from 1920 to 1956, every national issue that emerged on the scene, Dr. Ambedkar contributed. It was related to Dalit or not. In 1920, he participated in all constitutional proceedings. But when the question of Pakistan came, minority came, he wrote a book, Thoughts on Pakistan. Nobody had a book. It was only Dr. Ambedkar. He ran into two editions. When the question of women came, he brought Hindu code bill. Labor laws made by him when he was a minister. Water and power policy, he is the founder of this. Because Ambedkar is also ignored in the academic domain, mainstream academic domain. When the reorganization of the state brought the report, Ambedkar was criticized staunchly and wrote a book, Thoughts on Linguistic State. This was not a Dalit issue. So he was a man who was looking for rebuilding of India, and rebuilding particularly around the principle of equality, fraternity, justice. You know, Ambedkar should not be only focused in terms of constitution. One has to take him out, and there are every issue that arose between 1920 and 56. You name it, and he has a written statement, he has a solution. He was a pragmatic, but he is the only
person on the scene who studied and brought out in writing and gave a solution. He was a pragmatic, he was idealistic, but he was realistic also. He studied and then gave the solution that this is how it can be done.
I couldn't agree more, and I think it's somewhat of a travesty to be discussing his legacy in 40 minutes. But Christophe, moving on to your book, which is one of the most fascinating books I've read on Ambedkar. Your book is not organized chronologically. In fact, it's organized according to the strategies of emancipation that Ambedkar used in his struggle against caste oppression. And I think you identify them as identity building, please correct me if I'm wrong, electoral politics, working with governments, and of course, conversion. I wanted you to talk a little bit about the legacy of these strategies, their relevance today, the need to perhaps tweak them to respond to the times that we live in today, or perhaps come up with entirely new strategies. Would you please?
I would add one strategy that is probably the first one you followed, that is the understanding of the sociology of the country. Now, the caste system had to be understood properly. It's not really a strategy that is practiced, but it is the prerequisite, the intellectual understanding of what is going on. And he was a thinker. We have not mentioned this so far. He was a social scientist. He was a thinker. He had read so much. He knew so many theories and others. So this is still relevant, of course, this understanding. It has to be continued. You need more Dalit studies. You need more understanding. You need more data. This is critically the problem now. We don't know really where Dalits stand in socioeconomic terms. So this is something, if we need to compare what he did and what has to be done, that could be continued. The three other strategies are also very relevant. I would not say that it was identity building, the first one you mentioned. I would say social reform, education. Educate, and educate for the three priorities that he gave. And it's still very much there. And Dalits are investing in education. They are not always rewarded for the education they got, but they are doing that. Power politics, you know, there would be probably a shift. We have not said that so far, but in 52, Ambedkar said, we should burn this constitution. Because you have this piece of law, but what matters is power relations in society, in politics. So there the emphasis would be more on party building, party politics, and what BSP has achieved is something no Dalit party had been able to achieve so far. So they are going in this direction with, I think, some Ambedkarite agenda. With one caveat, probably, they don't want to be junior partner anymore the way Ambedkar was prepared to be a junior partner. And he has suffered for that. And the Hindu court bill story shows that if you're a junior partner, you can't really push your point too far. And the last one is indeed conversion. How do you emancipate from Hinduism? You have to leave Hinduism. There is no other way. You can't reform Hinduism from the inside. This is the conclusion in 56 that he drew. Very fascinating, works that he wrote. Buddha and his Dhamma, for instance, is a fascinating book that should be reprinted and distributed, showing that caste system is inherent in Hinduism, and if you want to emancipate yourself, you have to create a separate identity. And this separation means conversion. And Buddhism is, of course, the easiest way to equality. And as he says, I've not found equality, liberty, and fraternity in the French Revolution. I have found it in Buddhism. So this is very much relevant for today. You know, and he did not see these things are shifting from one position to another one. It's cumulative. And by the way, the same year it converted, he also created RPI, saying party politics and conversion should go together. We should be in the world fighting on both sides. I think this is exactly what Dalits are doing today. There is hardly any difference in terms of strategies. The only possible change is that some of them have lost hope in the system.
Ambedkar was definitely a liberal person, believing in non-violent constitutional activities. Some of those who have lost hope have joined the Naxalites. They are not in large numbers, but you can see this alternative. Because how do you do, what do you do if you can't push your agenda legally, peacefully? Isn't it the other natural alternative that is revolution?
I hope to come back to a lot of points that you've raised, but we have very little time. Professor Thorat, I wanted to ask you quickly before I move on to Byapariji. Ambedkar was of the view, perhaps, that when it comes to reservations in academic institutions, they should continue. But it was perhaps the view that political reservations are not needed in perpetuity, are not needed for a long time. Has one sort of reservation, how does it compare to political reservation? I mean, how do we compare these two kinds of reservations that exist in this country? And I'll also include public service here. In terms of what they have managed to create for us as a society. And perhaps an addendum to that, if you have time towards, the end of your answer would be, I would ask you to imagine if what would have happened if political reservations had indeed ended in 1960s.
Yeah, I think let us understand first very briefly why reservation. I think right from 1919, the first memorandum that he submitted to the South Bureau Committee till the state and minority that he published in 47, there is a common thread that runs through this demand. The point is that the Hindu society, based on the caste system, does not give equal rights to the Dalit, social, cultural, economic and political. And as a result, he wanted a safeguard. Legal safeguard is won by through law, but then he wanted them to get a participation. And so the instrument that he suggested was reservation, that at least give them in proportion to their population as a safeguard against discrimination. Now, at that time, he proposed three spheres, as you rightly said, job, education, and politics, legislature, and he took politics first, but simultaneously he took the education also. The reservation in politics through separate legal trace was approved in 1931, 31-32 through Pune Pact. In 43, when he was a minister, he brought out a government order and got a reservation government job. And at that very time, he set up an education fund. So all the three reservation policies were started by him much before the independence. Now, your question is how these three policies serve each other and the issue of duration. I think this 10-year period for political reservation and no time limit for education and job reservation is grossly misunderstood and on purpose maligned. Let me give you the story. If discrimination is the best for reservation, and if there is a discrimination both in electoral processes and job and education, how come Dr. Ambedkar would ask 10 years for political reservation and no limit for other reservation? There is an issue there. All the three reservations were given in Pune Pact and afterward. In the Constitution Assembly, also Constitution Assembly approved the reservation for minority, religious minority and scheduled caste and scheduled tribe, approved by the Constitution Assembly. But Patel, in one fine morning, said that no reservation to anybody. And he went to the minority committee and passed the resolution, including scheduled caste. Now, Dr. Ambedkar has accommodated several things. He wanted separately allocated, he got reservation, it's fine. He wanted state socialism in the Constitution. He didn't get it, he accommodated. There are several accommodations he made. But here he thought that I came in the Constitution, he said in last speech, that I came in Constitutional Assembly to preserve the right of the scheduled caste. And that very policy, which is the most important, if it's taken away by Patel, then that's the end of it. So he, now the facts are known by Rashekar Undru's book, that he threatened to resign as the chairman of the drafting committee and created a crisis for the Congress. And it is through this accommodation then
okay, political reservation, job and other thing will remain, political reservation, but Patel proposed for 10 years. So it was all with a massive compulsion and pressure on Dr. Ambedkar, the 10-year limit had been put in. Our academician who are against reservation use that beyond a limit. So to answer your question, all the three reservations will continue as per Dr. Ambedkar as long as there is a discrimination. You have to have a safeguard against discrimination in electoral politics. I give you an example, two examples. Muslim constitute 14% of the population. They are only 4% of the reservation is, their reservation is gone. Women constitute 49% of the population. They are just 11 to 12%. Discrimination based on gender, discrimination based on religion. In a representative democracy, you have to have a mechanism whereby you give share to everybody. And therefore, Dr. Ambedkar's position is that there is no time limit for reservation as long as discrimination persists. There are countries like Japan, they took away a reservation for Burak women because they thought that Burak women are so economically developed that you don't need that support. But in India, you see the pathetic situation of the untouchable, the atrocities and untouchability. So I think this time question I have dealt. What the last I will quickly take this issue is that how they feed each other. You raise a very important question. They feed each other very well. If you have a reservation in education, you are educated, your employability increase and you get into reservation. You know the story of tribal, that there are not enough students educated, as a result reservation is not fulfilled. So education helps recruitment through the channel of reservation and helps. And the educated representative in the parliament, they perform more effectively. And what is important is that if you are in the legislature, through the different committees which make policies, you protect the interests of the scheduled caste. So I think they are very closely interlinked with each other and help each other.
व्यापारी जी दो सवाल मैं आपसे करूंगी. हमारे पास वक्त बहुत ज़्यादा कम है. पहला सवाल तो मैं ये करना चाहूंगी आपसे कि आप कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी के साथ जुड़े बंगाल में एक अरसे तक. क्या आप ये समझते हैं कि जो कम्युनिस्ट पार्टीज़ थीं, क्योंकि हम पॉलिटिक्स की बात कर रहे थे इस वक्त, कम्युनिस्ट पार्टीज़ जो इंडिया के में थीं, उन्होंने कास्ट को इग्नोर करके और क्लास के बारे में ज़्यादा बात करके और कास्ट को इग्नोर करके क्या एक दलित नेतृत्व जो वो खड़ा कर सकते थे वो करने से वो चूक गए?
अब हमको झेलेंगे ये लोग. कैसे हैं आप लोग? ठीक ठाक है ना? अच्छे है. अच्छे रहना कोई बुरी बात नहीं, अच्छे रहना ही चाहिए, लेकिन बहुत अच्छे रहना बहुत बुरी बात. कुछ लोग बहुत अच्छे रहने की चक्कर में कुछ लोगों को जीना दुभर कर दिया. 1% लोगों के हाथ में 73% संपद जो है जमा हो गया, ये बहुत अच्छे रहने के चक्कर में. मैं बंगाल से आया, दलित और दरिद्र समाज से आया. सिर्फ दलित नहीं, मैं दरिद्र भी हूं. आंगवचा वाले समाज बंटवारा हो गया, ऊंची जाति में हुआ, नीचे में हुआ, टाई वाले और आंगोछा वाले. हम आंगोछा वाले हैं. और एक बात है, हम पढ़े लिखे नहीं हैं. आप सब तो पढ़े लिखे हैं, शिक्षित लोग हैं. हम कोई स्कूल में कभी गए नहीं. जेल खाने का मिट्टी में एक लकड़ी का कुटका से लिखाई पढ़ी सीखा, तो सोच सकते हैं कि हम कितने बड़े विद्वान हैं. लिखी पढ़ी लोगों उनको बात लिखी पढ़ी लोग समझ सकते हैं. लिखी पढ़ी लोगों की बात अनपढ़ जैसे समझ नहीं सकते, और अनपढ़ लोगों की बात लिखी पढ़ी लोग समझ नहीं सकते. मैं अनपढ़ हूँ, मेरे बात आपको समझाने का प्रयास करूँगा. पता नहीं कर पाऊँ या नहीं पाऊँ, समझा दूँ बहुत अच्छा, और ना समझ पाए तो बहुत अच्छा. बंगाल में कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी जो श्रमिक और मजदूर श्रमिक कृषक, हालांकि कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी जो है वो मजदूर और किसान का हित का बात करके ही बनाया जाता है. बंगाल में भी बना. बाबा साहब ने कहा था, कहे थे, पता नहीं हिंदी के थोड़ा कहे थे कहा था उसमें थोड़ा आई थी आया था गड़बड़ हो जाता है वहां थोड़ा, कि पहले तो सामाजिक क्रांति होना चाहिए, नहीं होगा तो राजनीतिक क्रांति जो है वो हो नहीं सकता. कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी बहुत ऊंची भावना से कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी बनाया गया, लेकिन उनका लीडरशिप में जो बैठा था कौन लोग थे? वो तमाम ऊंची जाति के लोग थे। बाबा साहब की बात अगर मानते, राजनीति में हो, नौकरी में हो, समाज के हर क्षेत्र में जिसकी जितनी जनसंख्या उतनी उनका भागीदारी, यही तो कहा ना बाबा साहब, नहीं कहा तो आप ही लोग से हम सुने हैं, पता नहीं उन्होंने कहा कि नहीं कहा, आप लोग बता सकते हैं। तो वो देना पड़ेगा। इसीलिए क्या है, ये दलित लोगों को, वो ऊंची जाति के लोग जो है अपने नेतृत्व कब्जा करके रखने के लिए दलित को सामने नहीं लाया, महिला को नहीं लाया, मुसलमानों को नहीं लाया, बिहार वालों को नहीं लाया, इक्का दुक्का गुन चुन के रख दिया था उसमें। वो जो कहानी है, वो जो कुमीर है, सियार बच्चे को दिखाता है, एक एक उठाकर दस के दस खा गया, एक को दस बार दिखाता है। तो ऐसे हमारे दलित में से एक कांति विश्वास रख दिया, एक मुसलमान रिज्जक मुल्ला रख दिया, एक महिला में से बिंदा करात रख, एक एक रख दिया और दिखाने लगे लोगों को। लेकिन उनका हर एक का दिल में, अब ब्राह्मण बात कहिए या हिंदुत्व बात कहिए, जो भी कहिए, आरएसएस भी आप बता सकते हैं, बीजेपी भी आप बता सकते हैं, जो भी आपका मन चाहे, हालांकि उनका दिल के अंदर में वो बैठा हुआ था। हर एक जनऊ छुपा के रखते थे कमीज के नीचे, घर में पूजा पाठ चलता। आप मार्क्सवादी है तो मार्क्सवादी होने के नाते सबसे पहले आपको जात पात धर्म भग भगवान ये सब मानना नहीं पड़ेगा, मानना नहीं चलेगा, आप मान नहीं सकते। सुरजीत सिंह महान मार्क्सवादी नेता, उन्होंने उनका जो जात की, जो जाति का या जात का कुछ भी होगा, सिख धर्म का जो भेष, वही पंडित वहां बैठे थे, किसी ने अंगली नहीं उठाया, किसी ने नहीं कहा कमरेड ये तो एक जाति परिचय पोशाक है, तो कोई क्या माला वाला पहन के वो भगवा वस्त्र पहन के भी वहां जाके बैठ सकता है? उनको अगर इजाजत हो तो इनको भी इजाजत होना चाहिए। लेकिन किसी ने सवाल नहीं उठाया, क्योंकि हरेक जानता था कि हमारे अंदर में भी एक ब्राह्मणवाद बैठा है। अब ब्राह्मणवादी जो होगा, जात पात जो मानने वाला होगा, पॉलिटब्यूरो में दिया गया नहीं, जो आम लोगों की भागीदारी होना चाहिए था, मजदूर को, किसान को, दलित को, किसी को दिया गया नहीं। कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी, अरे क्या मैंने बोल, जिन पार्टी ने कभी बोला करते थे कि टाटा बिरला गोयंगा डालमिया सिंघानिया ये सब 75 परिवार देश का सबसे बड़ा नुकसान पहुंचाया है, उनको विनाश किए बगैर दास ये देश का कुछ हित हो नहीं सकता। और 34 साल शासन में रहने के बाद में वो बोलते हैं टाटा का कोई बाल भी नहीं बका कर सकता, सर फोड़ दूंगा, ये आवाज बोल रहा है कौन? एक कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी के लीडर। तो क्या वो कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी है? हालांकि मेरे हाथ में समय भी कम है, टोकेंगे। एक छोटी सी कहानी, आप ज्ञानी लोग हैं, आप विद्वान लोग हैं, आपकी भाषा में आपको थोड़ा समझाने का प्रयास करता हूँ।
व्यापारी जी सॉरी, मैं आपको टोक नहीं रही हूँ, लेकिन एक, क्योंकि हमारे पास समय कम है, एक और सवाल है जो मैं चाहती हूँ कि आप जिस पे बात कर सकें, क्योंकि अब हमारे पास समय खत्म एक्चुअली हो चुका है, हमें क्वेश्चंस लेने हैं। आपने शिक्षा की बात की, ठीक है, आपने खुद को पढ़ना लिखना सिखाया, जेल में आपने पढ़ना लिखना सिखाया, आप साहित्य लिखते हैं, उसमें से कुछ हद तक दलित साहित्य है, लेकिन आपने दलित साहित्य से परे भी बहुत कुछ लिखा है। बाबा साहेब का ये एक, जिसके बारे में हम पहले भी चर्चा कर रहे थे, उनका एक सपना ये था एजुकेट, जो जैसा कि क्रिस्टोफ ने कहा एजुकेट एजुकेट एजुकेट, और वो इसलिए पढ़ाई लिखाई पर उनका ध्यान ज़्यादा था क्योंकि उनका ये मानना था कि जो दलित आगे बढ़ेंगे, जो शिक्षा प्राप्त करेंगे, वो उनका ये सपना था कि फिर आगे चलकर पूरे दलित समाज के लिए वो काम करें, उनके उत्थान के लिए काम करें, उनकी प्रगति के लिए काम करें। आपको शिक्षा का मौका नहीं मिला, आपने फिर भी साहित्य लिखा, तो बाबा साहेब जी का ये जो शिक्षा का सपना था कि दलित समाज खुद के लिए काम करे, इसके बारे में आपके क्या विचार हैं?
फिर वही बात दोहराना पड़ेगा, मैं शिक्षित नहीं हूँ, बार बार सुनते सुनते आप भी थक जाएंगे या हिंदी में और एक शब्द पक जाएंगे, कुछ भी हो। मैंने जब लिखना पढ़ना सीखा, छोटी सी एक दायरे में मेरे को लेखक के रूप में, हालांकि लेखक नहीं हूँ, मैं लिखवाड़ हूँ, जैसे खेल के में लोग खिलवाड़ बन जाते हैं, और ऐसे लिखते लिखते मैं कुछ एक तो बन गया लेखक। तो नहीं मानता हूँ कि वो बहुत बड़े ऊंची सम्मान वाली बात है। जब हम लिखाई पढ़ी थोड़ा बहुत लिखना पढ़ना सीखे, तो हम सोचे कि भाई अपने जो विचारधारा चिंताधारा चिंता चेतना इसको थोड़ा विकसित करने के लिए हम जाए तो किसके पास जाए, स्कूल तो हम जा नहीं सकते, कॉलेज तो हम जा नहीं सकते, हमारे पास तो वहाँ प्रवेश के लिए जो मार्ग बनाया गया उसमें तो हम चले नहीं, तो एक ने कहा जाओ कॉलेज कभी आओ उसमें चले जाओ, वहाँ सब लेखक लोग रहते हैं वहीं जाओ। हम गए, बहुत सारे लेखक बैठे हैं गंभीर मुंह करके, तो एक ने कहा ये कौन है, बोले ये जानते नहीं मनोरंजन व्यापारी हो, तो तब तक थोड़ा पेपर ऊपर में नाम वाम आ गया था, अच्छा ये मनोरंजन, हाँ तो भाई तुम यहाँ कहाँ आए हो, हम सब तो तुम्हारे साथ, हालांकि उनका शब्द में ये भावना नहीं था लेकिन उनके शारीरिक जो भाषा है उसमें वो भाव भावना था कि तुम तो दलित हो अछूत हो, तुम अपने लोग उनके पास जाओ, यहाँ तुम्हारे लिए कोई जगह नहीं है, छोड़ दिए कपिया उसका कीमती चाय कभी पीना, आए गए दलित लोगों के पास, तो जाके देखे वही टाई बंधे हुए दलित लोग बैठे हैं, अभी सारे लोग बड़े बड़े नौकरी किए, किसी का अभी 1 लाख रुपया पेंशन मिलता है ऐसे सुनने को मिला, सब बड़े बड़े लेखक हैं, जिंदगी भर नौकरी वोकरी किया कुछ करने का था नहीं, अब रिटायर हो गया अब क्या करे, तो थोड़ा दलित साहित्य तो करते हैं, आया साहित्य तो करते, था हम उनके साथ जाकर के मिले, मेरे कमीज से पसीना का बदबू, मैं लुंगी पहना हुआ, चक चक चेहरा तो नहीं है मेरा, उन्होंने कहा ये कौन है, बोले अरे ये जानते नहीं हो पेपर वेपर में नाम आते रहता है ये वही रिक्शा वाला, बोला अरे तो तुम यहाँ क्या कर रहे हो, तुम रिक्शा वाले के पास जाओ, हम तो बाबू भद्र लोग हैं, तो दलित का बाबू भद्र लोग भी हमको खदेड़ दिया, आए हम रिक्शा वाले के पास, उनको बोले भाई हम तो तुम्हारे लोग हैं हमको मिला हुआ तुम्हारे साथ, उन्होंने कहा अरे यार तुम तो दारू महिंदा वाले पीने लगे हो बाबू लोग के साथ, हमारे साथ चुलाई कहाँ पीते हो, हमारे साथ गाली कहाँ बकते हो, जुए कहाँ खेलते हो, तुम कैसे रिक्शा वाला रह गए, वो खदेड़ दिया, हम किसी जात का किसी धर्म में टिक नहीं पाए, कोई हमको अपनाया नहीं, अकेले हूँ, ब्रात हूँ, दलित हूँ, दरिद्र हूँ, बाबा साहेब ने शिक्षा के लिए दलित समाज के लोगों को इसलिए वो मौका दिया, संरक्षण में नौकरी का इसलिए मौका दिया कि जो लोग को नौकरी मिलेगा जो शिक्षा प्राप्त होगा वो उसका नीचे जो है उसको उठाने का कुछ प्रयास करेंगे। मैं क्या बोलूं, दुखी सर में बाबा साहेब को बोलना पड़ा था कि ये शिक्षित लोगों ने हमको साथ धोखाधड़ी किया सबसे ज्यादा, संरक्षण के माध्यम से उनको तो पार्लियामेंट में जाने का मौका तो मिल गया लेकिन नीचे की तरफ नीचे की तरफ आपने लोगों की तरफ ताकने का उनको समय ही नहीं मिला। शिक्षा तो हर एक को मिलना चाहिए, हमारे को मिलना चाहिए, अगर छोटी सी उम्र में हमको वो बैला चलाने वाला एक लकड़ी का कुटकर ना पकड़वा के एक छोटी सी पेंसिल पकड़वा दिया होता, जयपुर आ पहुंचा जादवपुर रेलवे स्टेशन का फुटपाथ से ऐसे ही एक आंगोछा बिछा के ईटा सर में दे करके सोते थे, पुलिस वाले उनकी गिनती में कम होगा इसलिए लात मार के उठा के लेके जेल में डाल देते थे, उनको कोटा है महीना में कितना केस देना पड़ेगा, कितने बार हमने जेल गया, वो जीवन शायद झेलना नहीं पड़ता, आपने लोग भी हमारे ऊपर तो ताका नहीं और ऊंची जाति के लोग तो ताका ही नहीं, अब शिक्षा क्या शिक्षा किनको मिला किनको नहीं मिला, हमको तो नहीं मिला।
व्यापारी जी सवाल तो और भी थे लेकिन हमारे पास वक्त खत्म हो गया है, आई डेफिनेटली क्रिस्टोफ बिफोर क्रिस्टोफ वी आर गोइंग टू बी क्रिस्टोफ इज ऑल्सो गोइंग टू बी वी आर नॉट टेकिंग क्वेश्चंस राइट नाउ सॉरी क्रिस्टोफ इज ऑल्सो गोइंग टू बी लॉन्चिंग हिज बुक इन अ मोमेंट, बिफोर ही डज दैट अ वेरी क्विक क्वेश्चन क्रिस्टोफ, बिकॉज यू आर समबडी हु ऑल्सो हैज यू हैव रिटन एक्सटेंसिवली ऑन द आरएसएस वे बिफोर इट वाज इन द वोग to write about the RSS. In the 90s, when you started work on Ambedkar, I remember reading somewhere or you said somewhere that, you know, he was largely ignored and RSS, as we know, was staunchly opposed to Ambedkar for the largest part of their, for their existence. Then they ignored Ambedkar, but in the 90s, after the formation of the Samajik Samrasta March, they start to call Ambedkar their own. What do you think lies behind that very quickly? And what would he have made of the sort of brand of nationalism that presupposes that the Hindu way of life is the Indian way of life? Very quickly, before we launch your book.
I'll be quick, but I have not spoken much so far. Yes. So I would like to return to
please.
The reservation question. I have to add a footnote to what Thorat has said. When there is no reservation, Rajya Sabha, the media, the private sector, where are the Dalits? So if you remove reservations from where they are, there'll be no Dalit anywhere because the stigma is still there. It's not as bad as being a Muslim to be a Dalit, but it's pretty bad still. So this is clearly a point I wanted to make. On the RSS and Sangh Parivar stuff, they have not paid attention to them because of goodwill, but because they could not be ignored anymore. In 1989, BSP did better than BJP in Uttar Pradesh elections. So they had to open their eyes and look at these emerging vote banks, quote unquote. And as usual, they used the divide and rule kind of policy. Jatavs were with BSP, they focused on the Balmikis. And that way they could find the good Dalits who could promote their own Sanskritization way of seeing things. Now, how far is this agenda that is in Thorat at odds with the plan Ambedkar had for India? Two things only. A Congress-free India is not compatible with democracy, the way Ambedkar understood it. In a democracy, you don't have enemies, you have adversaries. It's a completely different game. And only this would be sufficient for him, not as a Dalit, but as a liberal, to fight. And at the second point, who is fighting in his name today? That's a very interesting transformation. Only a couple of years ago, everybody wanted to be under the umbrella of Ambedkar, and all of a sudden realized that, oh, what he said probably was not what we thought he said, or what we wanted him to say. And this is, of course, at a time when the values he was fighting for, freedom of expression, individual rights, are under pressure. Where are the NGOs and where are the FCRAs of the NGOs? Where are the universities? Where are the media who do not self-censor themselves? This is an India he would not recognize. And therefore he would say, I was right, this constitution would not do. It's not because you have the right constitution that you have the right democracy. You can have the best laws in the world, and India has the best laws in the world. Rights to education, rights to food, rights to everything, rights to information. What about the implementation? And that's what he was saying in his last speech. Here is the place, here is the site, here is the text. Now you have to make something of it. And he would be still waiting for that.
Thank you, Christophe. On that note, I wish we could have ended on a happier note, but on that note, can we, would you like to unveil your book?
Of course. The co-author of
Could we please request the co-author to join us on stage quickly and...
Sorry, we are not taking any question as the time is just running up and you know we stick with the time. So sorry for that.
I really apologize for that. I hope you appreciate that we were trying to cover a large bandwidth of topic. But this is a book I've been looking forward to. So hopefully you can read it and our panelists are around. So maybe you can ask them a couple of questions later.
So this is an anthology presenting the views of Ambedkar on democracy from 1919 till 1956.
And it's available in the bookshop.
It is available in the bookshop. OUP and the Institute of Dalit Studies made it possible. And of course, Narendra.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. And sorry once again that we couldn't take questions.
Big round of applause for all the panelists on stage. Sorry we couldn't take the question. But it was lovely to hear them. Christophe, will you be signing the book? Yeah.